Good morning. I am Professor Yusufu Alizota. I'll be facilitating course 101, which is a course being offered by several departments in the university. Now, the first topic that we shall be treating in this course is titled The Nature and Scope of Political Science. Now, in looking at this topic, we are going to try to achieve the following objectives. That at the end of this study session, we should be able to, one, define politics, two, state the development of political science as a field of study, and then explain what makes political science a science or an art subject. Well, in looking at what political science is, we try first to clear your minds by trying to present the picture of what political science is not. And in doing that, because a lot of people actually think that political science, is not something that they want to be involved with or involved in. So they look at it as something bad that should not be touched. So we say that political science is not and cannot be an exact science in the sense of natural science like physics, chemistry, geology, and so on and so forth. And that secondly, that political science is not an exact science like natural sciences because the material with which it deals with is incapable of being treated exactly the same way as physics or chemistry. So for the political scientist, you cannot look at it as an exact science. In science, the formula, for instance, for H2O, meaning water and oxygen, when mixed together, whether it is in Nigeria, in America, in Britain, wherever, once you bring those, components together and mix them, you are going to get water. And so it's the natural sciences like physics, chemistry, and geology are exact science. But political science is not. You cannot say that the way the legislature in America will behave will be the same way the legislature in Nigeria will behave, or the way the executive will behave in India will be the same with that of Britain. So it's not an exact science in the sense that you may not be able to even predict, but for the sciences you can easily do that. Then political science is not also a subject that is easy to deal with because of the material that the political scientist studies, which is the human being himself. While for the natural scientists, they deal with matter, and matter is anything that has weight and occupies space. And therefore, when you talk about matter, you're talking about things that you can control. Something like a stone, you can carry it to the lab and study it. Plant, you can carry it to the lab and study it. And all sorts of items that you can take with water, chemicals and so on, you can take to the lab and study. But in political science, the person you are studying is also studying you, because he knows that there are certain things you want to get from him, and therefore you try either to be evasive, not to allow you to get exactly what you want, and therefore you find that the subject matter of political science is always very, very difficult. But what we try to clear in the minds of our students is that political science is not something that is bad, because a lot of people look at it as they cannot play politics, evil, is bad, because in Nigeria particularly, where there is this notoriety about how politics is played, a lot of people don't want to be associated with it. And so they look at it as something not to be touched. But in this course, we would like to explain to you that it is not as true as those people are thinking that political science is not. So that is why we have taken this just little introduction to clear your minds from what political science is not. So now we'll go to the definition of politics. And there are quite a number of definitions, which I take them one after the other. And here are some of the definitions by various scholars. One is by Ernest Baker, 1962, 81, stated that politics is the process of making and execution of governmental decisions or policies. So for Ernest Baker, he looks at politics from the angle of the process of making and execution of governmental decisions or policies. So, and then we'll ask now, the question will be, why is it a process of making and execution of governmental decisions? That means that politics is seen from the perspective of policy formulation and policy implementation. This is largely what the government does. They formulate policies, and later, maybe as you develop your in the study of the course, you will be exposed to some theories which will also will try to use and try to explain policy or decision making, which is usually based on inputs which come from the environment. And at this point, I think a diagram may help, you know, to explain what we are trying to say. So right now, what you can see that I've just done a sketch of what you can, okay, so the sketch that I've made, as you can see on the system, is what we refer to as the systems theory. And the point I was making, based on the definition that was made by Ernest Baker, when he said that politics is the process of making an execution of governmental decisions or policies, I'm now trying to tell you that in making those policies which come into the government, because the entire, you know, the outside, or the, you know, what you find outside the system is what we refer to as the environment. And I think you need to really show that the entire place is called the environment. And this, so from the environment, anyway, I see EN, what's the environment? Things go, inputs come from the environment into the system in the form of demand and support. The demand could be for good governance, could be for water to be provided in a community, could be for a school to be constructed, or for roads, or for electricity, for whatever. So people can make demand, any kind of demand they feel they want to make. It goes into the political system. This is the whole system. Or sometimes they could give, render support to the system. And how do you support the system? You pay your tax, you turn out and vote during elections, and do all sorts of things that are seen as supporting, you know, a government. So once you make a demand, it goes into the system, and then it is the political authorities within the system that now convert, and that's why I have what we're referring to here as the conversion process. The conversion process is what goes into the political authorities, they now convert it into policies and decisions, which are now sent back again through a feedback mechanism, into the, we give a feedback, what you call a feedback. So people are now informed as to what decisions have been made, and if they are in support of the decision, they will not make further demand on the same issue. If they are not, they will still send it back in there as a demand. And so demands come in form of decisions and policies, which is now seen as output. And so if the conversion process does not convert this demand into output, you cannot see the work that the political authorities are doing. That means that they have no way of escaping, they must make sure they do their work. And the only way they can do it is to convert demands that are coming to the political system into decisions or policies of government, which will now be made to address a particular problem. And that, I think, is what Ernest Baker is saying politics is all about. It's about making decisions or making policies. We'll go ahead. Definition given by Harold Laswell and Abraham Kaplan, 1950, they define politics. Okay, good. Harold Laswell and Abraham Kaplan define politics as authoritative allocation of values, or who gets what, when, and how. And that to a large extent can be seen as influence. Who gets what, when and how. That means the political authoritative allocation of values shows that some individuals within the political system have influence, that they can do certain things that will now influence the political system. They now allocate the values. So for Harold Laswell, they are looking at, and Abraham Kaplan, they are looking at politics primarily from the point of view of the authoritative allocation of values. So we see a lot of values are allocated in the society. And when they say who gets what, because some people have to determine when they are going to get a dam in your community, when they are going to get a borehole, when they are going to get a health center, a health facility, a secondary school, whatever it is that you're going to get, who gets what, when you are going to get it, and how you are going to get it. Then Austin Renani maintains that politics is a process of resolution of conflict in society. Because one of the conditions for the survival of politics is conflict. And the conflict doesn't necessarily have to be violent. Conflicts could be, you know, conflicts of interest. Because this community wants water, another community wants school, another community wants a road. So these are conflicting demands. They don't want the same thing. And therefore you have to prioritize. Which one will you do now? When will you do it? And all that. So Austin Rarani is saying that politics is a process of resolution of conflict in society. And of course, even when the violent conflict takes place, it is the politics that will be involved in resolving the conflict. Because even when people fight wars, they end up on the table to negotiate peace. And so whichever way we want to look at it, whether it is a violent conflict or a non-violent conflict, that politics is a process of resolving conflict in society, because there will be different type of conflict in any society. Wherever people are gathered together, their interests will not be the same. So there will be several conflicting interests, and therefore the role of politics is to resolve those conflicts. Then we'll go to the fourth definition given by Max Weber. Max Weber looks at politics as the operation of the state and its institutions. Politics for him means the sharing of power to influence the distribution of power among individuals and groups within a state. So politics for him means the sharing of power to influence the distribution of power among individuals and groups within the state. So within the state, the state operate different institutions, and therefore they share power. And if we're talking about power sharing, it means you are also, we should not forget that in the views of later we shall see that you have different arms of government, and so, and you have different tiers in some countries, different tiers of government, and all these tiers have different power allocated to them, and the aim of the allocation is to determine the level of the influence. So Max Weber is informing us all that politics is the operation of the state and its institutions. So how does the state operate, and what are the institutions of the state that are operating? So you can talk about different institutions that are established by the state to operate. If you take the issue of security of lives and property, which is one of the primary functions of the state, is to the protection of lives and property. And for that reason, most countries have a military. So how do they operate? If the military now abandons its own responsibility that we have seen in Africa and elsewhere, in Asia and Latin America, to not be busy with power issues, taking over governments and all that, then they have abandoned their responsibilities, and they are going to areas that doesn't concern them. But primarily, the responsibility of that institution is to maintain and use the instruments of the coercion of the state for the maintenance of law and order. And they have different institutions within the state that are given different responsibilities. Then Laswell, Harold Laswell, finally suggests that politics is essentially a struggle for positions of power and influence by which those who succeed in monopolizing such positions in society are able to make decisions that affect the lives of every citizen within the country. So he sees politics largely from the position of the struggle for power and influence, and that those who succeed in getting the power will monopolize it, because they will use it to make decisions that affect the lives of other citizens who may not be involved in the competition for power. And so Harold Laswell is virtually looking at politics from the perspective of the struggle for power and influence, which is also essential because those who eventually get into power positions are the ones that determine who gets what, when and how. They are the ones that will not determine whether a school, a clinic, whatever is going to be provided in a community. And so that's why we can say that looking at all these decisions or these definitions of politics, we shall now also look at the way politics can be simplified. And just a very simple, so let's go to look at how we can simplify the definition. So politics can simply be defined in three ways. One, first, it attempts to discover the general principles, formation and functioning of government. I look at the general principles relating to the formation and functioning of government. Secondly, it is concerned with people and the way in which they make decisions and the way those decisions are reached. How do they reach the decision? It's also very important. And then thirdly, politics is that part of the social sciences which treats the foundations of the state and the principle of government. Government, social and economic programs, international relations, organizations and corporations. So when you look at politics generally, they fall into these three different broad categories. That the first is that it's an attempt to discover the general principles in the formation functioning of government, which may also take us to look at the origin of the state and the rights of citizens and all those other issues that are associated with the functions of government and the duties of the government itself. Then secondly, it is concerned with people and the way in which they make decisions and the way those decisions are reached, because there are several theories of decision making. How are decisions reached? Well, so the various theories will tell you how you can take a decision that is rational and a decision that is not rational. So there are decision making theories, one of which we've just tried to look at. For instance, the systems theory tells you that there will be input and there will be output. So how do you decide? If you want to take a trip to Lagos, you look at whether you have the funds to travel or you don't, and that will determine your decision. So decision is not based on irrationality, because every human being seems to be rational. The rationality itself is bounded by time, by information, and of course by resources. Because if you are going to take any decision, you don't have all the time in this world to take decision. You have to decide at a particular time A is going to be done or B is going to be done. Then how you take this decision is influenced by the resources available to you. You want to build maybe a Olympic sized stadium. Do you have the resources? You now look at where are you going to get the money from. If you don't have it, you cannot be taking a decision that you want to build it. That's why we have a lot of projects in the country abandoned, because decisions are not sorted out in terms of the time decisions are taken, in terms of the funds that are available for decision making, and the information, because any decision you want to make must be guided by information that you have. What is the information available to you? Then thirdly, politics is that part of the social sciences which treats the foundation of the state. So we'll try to look at the state. What is the foundation of the state? What are the principles of government? What are the governmental social economic programs that are executed by the state? How does one state relate to another state in terms of international relations or international organizations? And how do you cooperate with other states? These are all very important aspects when you are looking at politics. And that's why we said that politics, based on the definitions given by the different scholars, or categorize them to these simple three different ways that you can look at them. Then we'll now progress to look at the development of political science as a field of study. And we're going to look at basically the ideas drawn from Jean Bodin and Baron de Montesquieu. European political philosophers established a narrow definition of politics. And some of the definitions we look at are the ones given here. That if Jean Bodin, a French political philosopher who first used the term political science, was a lawyer. And because of his legal training, Bodin focused on the characteristics of the state more than any other aspect of the political process. So he concentrated on analyzing the relationship between the organization of the state, and how this relate to law. How is the state organized? How does it relate to law? As one of the early, you know, philosopher that has used the term political science. Okay, so Jim Bodine is one scholar that tried to establish and analyze the relationship between organization of the state and how this relates to law. I want to, when we come to, you know, discuss some of the theories of the state, we shall look at the theories that also relate to the rights of citizens, and we also try to establish some of the rights as it relates to law. Because in terms of law, there are laws that are natural. Okay, and some of the natural laws are, of course, the ones that we have commonly, is that of self-preservation. How do you preserve your life? And that is why you find that one of the principal responsibilities of the state is to protect that law which is natural to you. Your liberty or freedom to movement, which is also natural. Your freedom of speech, which is also natural. These are natural rights. They are innate laws. So they are given to you. If you believe in God, then we say it's given to you by God. So it's not a human being that gave you the right. And that's why you cannot be stopped from moving from one place to another. You cannot be stopped from exercising your speech. And you cannot be stopped from, you know, being alive until you answer the natural call of dying. And so therefore the state is also supposed to be seen from the perspective of law. And so the laws are laws that are given. Laws are given by man and they are not natural. So you look at those laws that are created by man himself for the purpose of regulating the behavior of man. Because there are several theories also that try to explain how man, without government or without law, can, you know, operate his life without any form of restriction, without knowing that there is no any police. And we know, for instance, as Nigerians, even though we may not want to agree, but it is known that in Nigeria, if he doesn't see a law enforcement officer by the roadside watching over, if it's supposed to be a traffic point, tendency is that he's going to break the law. When the light is showing red, he will pass. But when he goes to where the laws are working and he knows that he will be arrested, he obeys the law because he knows that he will be arrested. So there's this way we, you know, respond to law. So what Jim Bodine has done is to actually look at the relationship between the organization of the state, and therefore you look at all the tiers of and the arms of government that we set up, how they relate to law, how are they all established. Then Baron de Montesquieu is another French philosopher. I argue that the functions of government could be encompassed within the categories of legislation, execution, and adjudication of law. Montesquieu categories found their way into the United States Constitution or the Republican Constitution with the assumption that liberty was best assured by separation of powers between the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary. So when we are separating power, because Montesquieu's classic work actually gave birth to this idea about separation of powers, why you need to separate the legislature, that is the law-making arm, and why they are supposed to be making laws. They have executive arm to execute the laws made by the legislature, and then the judiciary to interpret the laws made, and therefore find that no one single person will belong to these three organizations at the same time. If there's any such situation, then you cannot be able to guarantee the liberty of the citizens. It means that there will be abuse of power, because power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And so when somebody now is the executive, the legislature, and judiciary at the same time, tendency is that he's going to misuse the power. He's going to abuse such power, and that will not go well. So political science actually started, you know, from such, even though we trace it to the Greek city-states. You see, because that's where, for instance, you know, you had this ancient practice of democracy that is direct. And a lot of the studies that we actually conduct try to relate to those, you know, studies that were done in ancient Greek societies, and then of course later by European scholars like the French, you know, philosophers. And so from here now we shall dovetail into looking at whether political science is a science or is an art. We'll look at some of the, let's go to the next. Science and political science as a science. Now, when we say science, Then of course, we know that science has some unique characteristics. One is that it is verifiable. This verifiability we're talking about is that whatever you want to do can be verified scientifically. Then it is a system. Okay, when you go to the lab, there are ways in which you set your equipment and then you test your chemicals or you test, you know, the objects that have been taken into the lab. And then usually a scientific finding will, or findings will have general, you know, it is generalized. It has some kind of generalization or some kind of universality. That means that, like the example I initially started giving you about hydrogen combined with oxygen, some, you know, will produce water. Now, when we now have this, is easily verifiable, and there's a system that you'll use to verify that, and to have a universal applicability. That means it can be applied anywhere. The same law being applied is the same. So when you're doing chemistry, the way you do it in Nigeria is the same way you do it elsewhere. But that may not be so with political science. And therefore, we now try to see how do we derive this scientific nature of political science. So we'll go to the scientific characteristics. So this, some of these factors we've identified, we try to see whether they can be, you know, applied to political science. So the scientific character of political science, we'll say that political science, like other social sciences, has a scientific character because of the scientific method it employs in examining the phenomena it wants to study. That is, it is a science to the extent that it accumulates facts that are verifiable, links these facts together and in a causal sequence systematically, and from this makes generalizations of fundamental principles and formulate theories. Okay, so, and that's why also in political science we have a number of theories that we have, that we're able to, political scientists are able to formulate. And that is why the, a lot of political scientists will tell you that even though we may not want to go into some of these examples now, but later as we continue to study, we'll bring quite a number of them that will show us that political science, you can make generalizations and you're likely to get the same results. But there are instances where you may have same feature, same tendency, but the results are not the same. But in most instances, where we're able to assemble our facts that are verifiable, the facts are verifiable, and then link these facts together in a causal sequence systematically, and from this, make generalization of fundamental principles and formulate theories, then to that extent, we can say that political science is a science. Then we'll look at the characteristics. So we'll stop at this point. When next we meet, we're going to continue to conclude, you know, by looking at some of the characteristics or the character of political science that makes it scientific. So on this note, let me thank you for your attention. We hope that we have learned one or two things. Thank you.